A major feature of the RNL Revolution Nothing Less show is called American Crime. This is a series that appears on revcom.us, and it begins with this, that Bob Avakian has written that one of the three things that has to happen in order for there to be real and lasting change for the better is that people have to fully confront the actual history of this country and its role in the world up to today, and the terrible consequences of this. And in that light, and in that spirit, American Crime is a regular feature of revcom.us. We have 100 installments, and each one of them documents one of the 100 worst crimes committed by the U.S. rulers out of the countless of bloody crimes that they have carried out against people from around the world, from the founding of the United States to the present day. The RNL show has adapted 7 of these American Crime series into short films, and they've been created by the filmmaker David Zeiger. In 2005, David created a multiple award-winning film that's been seen around the world, it's been on television and in theaters nationwide, called Sir No Sir, that documents the GI resistance movement in the Army in opposition to the war in Vietnam.
During the Vietnam War, an anti-war movement emerged that altered the course of history. This movement didn't take place on college campuses, but in barracks and on ships. It flourished in Army stockades, Navy brigs, and the dingy towns that surrounded military bases. Hundreds went to prison and thousands into exile, and by 1971 it had, in the words of one colonel, infested the entire armed services.
Mr. President, there's a terrible demonstration going on outside.
Oh, there's always a demonstration going on outside, Pat.
Yeah, but Richard, this one is completely out of control. They're storming the White House.
Oh, in that case, I better call out the 3rd Marines.
You can't, Richard.
Why not?
It is the 3rd Marines.
Yes.
This film, which you can get on various, most of the streaming services, is very relevant and of tremendous importance today, showing the kind of resistance that is possible and necessary in the U.S. military, particularly now as this proxy war by the U.S. could gear up into a hot war. David also created and produced and directed a landmark 13-part documentary series, Senior Year, that was broadcast on PBS in January of 2002. The series follows a group of 15 students at Fairfax High, which is the most diverse school in the city here of Los Angeles. So I have in the studio here David Zeiger. Welcome back.
Hi. Thank you. I usually prefer being behind the camera, but this is good.
Okay. Well, you've been here before, and so this show, we have to make that kind of sacrifice.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about this series on revcom.us and how that series strikes you.
Well, for one thing, I mean, I encountered the series, I don't know, years ago, and I've always been stunned at how thorough it is and how massive it is. I mean, every crime is very, very carefully documented, illustrated. It really is a very powerful tool, something to really learn from and to get out. And when I started making these short films based on it, one thing, I mean, the material is there. In these pieces, most of the material, not all of it, but most of it is there. And I draw the narration from those pieces and add a little bit of my own sensibility, some humor, where effective and where it makes sense. Some further information that I've learned in the course, for example, of making Sir No Sir, about the My Lai Massacre and the fact that it was only one of hundreds that were carried out in Vietnam, that the U.S. military had themselves uncovered and then buried. So it's both a powerful, each one of these is both powerful in itself, but they're also a really strong platform to build off of, to add to. And of course, in today's world where just about everything is being, you know, almost all information is coming on online and on all these various different platforms, short films can be a very, very strong, very, you know, striking way of bringing history to life.
Right.
And as Bob said in that quote, I mean, you look at, I mean, history is one of the big battlegrounds right now with the fascist movement in this country. I mean, there's a reason they are going after Black history. And so the both the opportunity and the real necessity right now to tell these stories. It's also a very complicated time, you know, with the Russian invasion of Ukraine and with the fact that most people, what they see is these horrific crimes that are being carried out by Russia. And in fact, they are being carried out by Russia, and people are becoming outraged by that. And people are wanting to know what do I do about that? And it's not an easy question. And it's in that context, because at the same time, you know, it's very clearly the United States is turning this into a proxy war with Russia and pushing things towards World War III. Understanding what it means that this country was built on all these crimes is crucial to knowing what to do, you know, how to act in the face of this. I mean, when I posted one of these on the My Lai Massacre recently on Facebook, and I got some interesting, you know, pushback from progressive people who said, well, so what? That's not what's going on now. What's going on now is what Russia's doing. And it opened up a lot of very good discussion about, you know, what does it mean to know about these things? What does it mean that the United States, you know, is the only country that bombed, you know, that dropped the atom bomb and still maintains the right to do so in today's world? That's really important to get into.
Well, why don't we watch just a few clips from a couple of the films that you've produced?
Here's something to think about. How is it that during the 90 years from the end of Reconstruction to the 1960s, thousands of Black people in the South could be publicly lynched and the federal government not lift a finger to stop the lynchings or punish the perpetrators? It's not like they didn't know what was happening. Historical records show that in 1893, for instance, one lynching occurred in the South every 40 hours. But did the federal government do anything to stop the century-long reign of terror? Not a chance. Why? There is an answer, and to find it, you need only travel back in time to the years following the Civil War, known as Reconstruction, and the tiny town of Colfax, deep in the heart of Louisiana.
On this day in 1767, Andrew Jackson was born on the backwoods soil of the Carolinas. From poverty and obscurity, Jackson rose to glory and greatness, first as a military leader and then as the 7th President of the United States. He did it with courage, with grit, and with patriotic heart. And by the way, he was one of our great presidents.
We took a little trip along with Colonel Jackson down the mighty Mississippi.
Andrew Jackson, war hero, slaver, virulent racist, and the 7th President of the United States. But the pinnacle of his fame rests on the Indian Removal Act of 1830. Then they marched the Indians more than 1,200 miles to Oklahoma. Whooping cough, typhus, dysentery, cholera, and starvation were epidemic along the way, and historians estimate that more than 5,000 Cherokee died on that journey. Okay, here's a pop quiz. What was the site of the biggest race riot in the history of this country?
Oklahoma, where the wind comes sweeping down the plain.
That's right. The great state of Oklahoma, home of lovable farmers and ranchers who just need to learn how to be friends and share all those wide open spaces. In the decades following the Civil War,
Oklahoma was the destination for both white settlers and former slaves looking to build a new life. When Oklahoma became a state in 1907, the very first law they passed legalized and enforced racial segregation. After all, they had to make it a real American state. White rioters begin firing on blacks and setting fire to black-owned homes and businesses late into the night. Then as dawn approaches, literally thousands of armed whites, some estimated as many as 10,000, gathered in three locations on the edges of Greenwood. A siren sounds at daybreak, and the mobs of white terrorists launch their invasion.
So that's just a small taste of what you see in these short films based on American crime. And look, the purpose of us doing on this show is, first of all, to say that we bring this to you on the RNL show, and people can learn a tremendous amount, as David was bringing out before, by watching these and by spreading them to your friends, showing them to your relatives, and bringing, if you're a teacher, bring them into school, a professor, bring it into the college, or on this, take it out on the street and show it to people, as well as in any group you're in. These are very important. People do need to know how we got to the mess we're in right now, and this history is decisive. But second, and a focus for today, we have David here because we want to encourage you and those of you who want to make films or are making films in creating American crimes based on this series. So, David, you spoke there about how you take these and you appreciate the content, but then you go about doing it. What's the first thing you do? And then you also mentioned that sometimes you use humor or music in it. We saw some music in one of these clips from a Native American. And so if you could just talk a little bit about that process, how you start, and what, if people want to make a film, what's their first step?
Well, in this case, the first thing is to write the script. I mean, I read the and kind of I study the piece on RevCom. I do, you know, I hate to use that term. I do my own research. I look for more additional information, and I look for visuals. You know, there's the script, and then obviously there's the visuals, and those two things have to really work with each other. You know, and that's one of the things that's incredible about the web. I mean, there's, you know, you can find so much in terms of, you know, visuals telling these stories. And in the course of putting it together with, you know, with the script and the visuals, things, you know, come up, things happen, things appear that would make sense. For example, using the musical Oklahoma.
Sweeping down the plain.
For those of you who don't know, Oklahoma is an iconic American musical that was from the early 1960s. It has this aura of portraying the reality of the American West as it was settled by, of course, white people, ignoring things like the Tulsa Massacre. And I think irony is a great thing to do to use in any kind of film. And I think I look for that kind of a point counterpoint, that kind of, you know, you saw this with the Trump speeches where, you know, one thing is being said, and in fact, the reality is something quite different. And contrasting that, I think, brings things home in a way that sticks, that people really connect with.
I think that's important. In fact, it is how people learn. And we try actually through the show as a whole to do always be juxtaposing what people commonly think, what the ruling class tells you, what different strata tell you, different pundits tell you, and what the actual reality is. But we want to get right now, before we close the segment, David, to the actual proposal. The first thing we want to ask you to do is go to the series on revcom.us, look through. There's 100 American crimes. There could be 10,000 crimes. In fact, for every year of the U.S.'s history, they have invaded, staged a coup, and intervened in one country or another. But go through that, and if you feel inspired to take one of these up, write us a proposal of what you want to do and why, and how you see doing it, and, you know, in brief. And then, you know, we'll write back to you or get in touch with you, and then we can get underway. And David, you said that you would be willing to be an advisor.
I would love to do that. I'd love to help get a lot more of these made. I know that there's folks out there you know, who are far more creative than I am, and who can really turn these things into a very dynamic part of what goes on this show and what goes on the web generally. So yes, absolutely. I'd be very willing to meet with, to talk with, to help whatever people want to do with this series.
Well, that would be really be a tremendous contribution to the show. And I have to say, for any aspiring filmmaker, for any filmmaker, it'd be really an exciting and enriching thing to actually work with David. He's kind of modest about it, but this, you know, A Sir, No Sir is an award-winning film. It's not the only awards he's won. And I think this would be a really important project, and it would help spread this show and spread the true history of the U.S., which is one of the things people have to know and understand to be able to make the kind of change that is needed in this country and in the world, revolution for a whole radically new world. So, David, I want to thank you for being here today and for making these films. And
thank you.
All right. Okay. Yeah.